Hi, folks. This being Washington, I'm here to introduce the introduction. My name is Andrew Quinn. I work with Aspen Global Health and Development here at the Aspen Institute. We're thrilled to be co-hosting this event with our friends from USAID's Center for Accelerating Innovation and Impact. The main topic under discussion today, public-private cooperation in global health, is one that we care a lot about at Aspen Global Health and Development, and we're looking forward to a really interesting session. Thanks to you all for coming to Aspen to be a part of it. So without any further introduction from me, I will turn you over to your next introducer, who is Wendy Taylor, who is director of the Center for Accelerating Innovation and Impact. Wendy.
Thank you so much, Andrew. Good afternoon, everybody. Very excited to have you all here and get this, what I think is going to be a great discussion going. Let me indulge me for just a minute to give some big thank yous. And so huge thanks to Andrew, our friends, our good friends at the Aspen Institute, including Peggy Clark, Katie Dressler, Denise, who's around here somewhere. But thanks so much for your continued partnership and many things Global Health, having us over for a lovely lunch and what should be a thoughtful dialogue. Big shout out also to Shira Kilcoyne, who has been a great partner for years, and I think we're excited to get some of these things out in the public a bit. And thanks to our team, Jen Fluter, Dave Milestone, Rachel Fowler, for putting this event together. So, for those who don't know, our Center for Accelerating Innovation and Impact is a center of excellence within the Global Health Bureau at USAID, and we're focused not only on catalyzing global health innovation, but also bringing in business and marketplace thinking so that we can develop innovations faster, get them introduced and scaled much more effectively. And a key part of that involves partnerships, and that's a big thing that we're going to talk about today. And that's been a big theme throughout this administration. And USAID has focused a lot on pursuing new models of development. And part of that is really thinking about how we can much more creatively and proactively bring private sector in to be able to create creative, cost-effective, results-oriented development solutions. And that's central to how we do business. Now, that is nothing new for USAID. We've been doing public-private partnerships since our founding, and we have many great examples. But how we partner is new, and we're thinking about new ways to do that. So before, we would often bring our implementing partners together. We'd think about some development challenge. We might put together a partnership. And then bringing the private sector player on was really almost the afterthought. How do you bring them into that equation? And what we're trying to do is say, let's actually think about how to bring private sector players much more purposefully into these conversations, think together about how we can solve some of these tough development challenges, and that requires having them at the table from the outset. Now, the time is really, we think, right for this kind of way of working together. So certainly from a development perspective, we know we certainly don't have all the resources we need to get the health outcomes that we need, but also don't have all the expertise. So there's a real advantage to working with the private sector in new ways. And from the private sector's perspective, from a corporate business interest perspective, they're looking at slowing economies in the US and Europe. And some of the biggest areas of growth actually are in some of these emerging markets. If you look at growth for demand for healthcare commodities in Africa, it's some of the strongest in the world over the next decade. So there's a real interest in tapping into that. You've also got low and middle income countries that have unprecedented economic expansion. So how do we actually tap into that in new ways? So a few years ago, we started doing some brainstorming with GSK, which has been a real leader in global health and market access, and thinking about how we can find some areas of common interest and identify those and think about what we could do together. So we shortlisted a handful of ideas and thought about community health, innovative financing, chlorhexidine, which is an antiseptic for newborn cord care, which is a priority commodity for us to scale up, and even how GSK might be able to help some of the innovators we support through Saving Lives at Birth Grand Challenge, where we have a really robust pipeline of innovations. And so we really focused on those, came up with action-oriented plans to move forward, and a number of those are underway already. And I'm just going to highlight two very quickly to set the stage for our conversation. One is called Aspen Management Partnership for Health, AMP Health. It's actually led by the Aspen Institute. And it was really, it's a partnership that was created on the notion that the private sector has a role to play and, in fact, a vested interest in supporting the development of robust health systems. And it's also built on the belief that if we can bring in private sector and business-minded leadership skills and capabilities and bring that into ministries of health, we can strengthen community health systems and help them scale. So AMP is really a vehicle for doing just that. It's a partnership. It involves GSK, Merck, Aspen, of course, NGOs, and ministries of health so far, Kenya, Malawi, and Sierra Leone. But it's really a platform that many private sector partners could come in and join and play a role in. And certainly we can expand even to areas beyond community health. The second that I want to highlight is around innovative financing. And we're really excited. Actually, just today we have announced a new partnership around innovative finance. It's a partnership that GSK has really played a leadership role in forming with our team. It involves Imperial Health Sciences, Aspen Pharmacare, Absa Bank, and Pfizer, as well as USAID. And it's really focused on strengthening independent community pharmacies in underserved areas. And what that means is, you know, we noticed early on, and actually this came out of a conversation that Ramil Burden and I had, where we were interested in supporting, we were talking about how we're interested in supporting some of these small little drug shops. One of the reasons why they can't keep their shelves stocked is it's just a working capital problem. They don't have the regular financing to keep the right drugs on the shelves. And that's just working capital. Those are the kinds of things USAID's actually good at helping with. So we were thinking, how can we do this on a wholesale basis? And Ramil said, we're actually already doing this. And it sort of opened our eyes to the fact that actually, pharma companies have a real interest in being able to access some of these harder-to-reach markets. And so how can we work together to really come up with a partnership? So I won't go into too much details. We have a press release on it. But it's really exciting new way of working, and we're hoping this is something that will be a very scalable idea. So just with that, I think one of the things we want to bring out in the conversation today is, you know, really thinking about how we can take the kinds of things that GSK has done as a company in terms of being a real leader in global health, but even the kinds of ways we're even looking at working together, and how can that be a model for working with the private sector more effectively in terms of strengthening health, strengthening equity for health and health impact in the developing world. So with that, it is my pleasure to introduce our session today. So our speaker, Sir Andrew Witty. He has been hailed as one of the most influential people in biopharma today. There's really no better person to speak on private sector innovation, partnerships, and access to medicines. And he and GSK, through his leadership, has demonstrated to the world that by being thoughtful around different business models, you can actually be an innovation company and you can focus on supporting access to medicine in poor parts of the world. So Sir Andrew Scott has an esteemed and distinguished career at GSK for over 30 years, has served as CEO since 2008, and earlier this year, I think to many people's dismay, he announced his retirement and will be retiring in March of 2017, I believe. Andrew's expanded vision of how to partner and help save children's lives around the world is, I think, really played a leadership role, and we applaud you for that. Now, Sir Andrew is joined by Maggie Fox, who is a senior health writer at NBC News, and I think she's going to lead what I'm sure is going to be a quite stimulating, engaging fireside chat without the fire. And Maggie is no stranger to these issues. She has over 20 years of experience reporting on health, science, medicine, and technology, including with National Journal and Reuters. So with that, I ask you all to join me in welcoming them to the session.
Sir Andrew, thanks so much for being here. How's it feel to be one of the good guys?
We're not always one of the good guys, or we're not always portrayed that way. I think if you ask the people who work for the company, though, it's incredibly important that we are focused just as much on the access agenda as we are on the innovation agenda, and certainly we know objectively that the number one retention trigger for employees in GSK and the number one hiring trigger for employees is the access work we do. And if we look at somewhere like the UK, where obviously we're a British company, so we have a substantial presence there, we're second only to Google in our attractiveness to university students. And I'm not sure anybody ever beats Google in these lists. So, and that's because of what we do. So, I think working over the last few years to really balance in everything we do, the agenda of access alongside the innovation agenda has been a huge win-win for the organization. And I think over the last 3 or 4 years, I think it's fair to say that a lot of what we've been doing has really started to achieve a materiality impact. It's very easy in global health, or frankly in anything, but of course in global health, where there is such a gigantic need to be very, very busy doing lots of things. I spent yesterday afternoon with the Kenyan health minister who was complaining there are too many pilots in healthcare. We all pilot things all the time. The question is, can we convert these things to real materiality, really lift not just a few hundred or a few thousand people, but tens and hundreds of thousands of people forward? And I think we've started to feel over the last few years that the work we're doing is really getting into that level. And I think that makes a huge difference on the ground. And it's certainly something that the people of GSK want to be part of.
Well, I have to say it was somewhat brave of you to come to Washington, D.C. in a week when other heads of companies are being pulled up in front of Congress and accused of money grubbing. But you also have a corporate responsibility to your shareholders. How do you reconcile that, the desire to be a company that people admire and that is helping the world, with the need to bring a maximum profit to your shareholders?
Well, I'd kind of broaden that answer out a little bit from the subject of global health into a much broader issue. Which is really that we're living in an era which is actually unique, I think, not just of technological transformation, not just globalization, but also of somehow global transparency and global internationalization. What I mean by that is that we've now got huge numbers of people in the world who almost instantly, without going anywhere, have a window on the rest of the world. It's through social media, through all sorts of connections. Kids who are coming out of school in every continent are immediately internationalist in the way they think and the way they observe. And that's going to require a tremendously different approach to the way in which big companies operate. If you then combine that with technological change, digitization, there are huge pressures on old business models of industries around the world, and pharma's no different to that. And so I think it's incredibly important that boards and leadership, particularly in this era, are not just innovating the products, are not just driving their old business model to the final point of efficiency, but are really reflective around what they need to do to innovate their business model. Now, for us, that means how do we innovate to open up access in the developing world, particularly at the lowest level of economic development. It means how do we open up productive economic relationships with the upper middle of that developing world, and how do we start to take some of the pressure off the developed world? Because actually some of what you're seeing here in Washington and elsewhere is symptomatic of a system which has become ever more dependent on, frankly, the US consumer and US prices, when in fact the capacity of even the US consumer to afford these prices is under great pressure. completely unsurprisingly, that produces reaction and criticism. The industry has to think very strategically, companies have to think very strategically how they respond to that. One of the ways to respond to that is, first of all, be more responsible about pricing here in the US. We've introduced our last six major products into the US have been launched at or below the prices of the previous generation of technologies, not at price premium. And at the same time, through the work we're doing in the developing world, as Wendy alluded to, we're seeing ever-growing volumes in the developing world. In fact, in the last 5 years, we've doubled the volume in Africa of product we sell. And overall, in the emerging markets, we sell 40% more volume than any other drug company. What that's doing is allowing us to create a relief valve on the pressure in the developed world. It's allowing us to drive forward our earnings and profits at the company. And it's allowing us to continue to drive R&D forward. But it's only been possible through a really quite fundamental strategic pivot of the business model. The shareholders are massive beneficiaries of this. And I think what we've seen in industry after industry is that companies have, and the banks are probably a very good example of this, companies have, for whatever reason, chosen not to innovate or have been encouraged by their shareholders to drive their pre-existing business model to the point of collapse. And when it happens, it's a catastrophic disaster for the industry. So in the case of the banking sector, provokes such dramatic reaction, it's been now massively regulated to the point where it's hard for the banking sector to function as a banking sector. What we don't want is anything like that in pharmaceuticals, because if anything like that happened in pharmaceuticals, you would end up with a generation of lost R&D, because the reaction would be a complete setback in R&D. It would take us a generation to restart it. This is why it's so important to strike this balance of innovation and access. And it's not beyond the wit of humankind to be able to do two things at once. And I think that we should be, you know, for me, it's always a slightly surprising question. How could you possibly do access when you're an innovative profit-making company? Well, we do both. And guess what? We've made more profit since we've been doing access than before. Not because we're making money from that, but I think probably because we've hired better people because we've been doing that. And those better people have helped us drive our whole business forward.
So the partnership that Wendy was just talking about, how does that fit into everything that you've just said?
Well, it's a very logical fit when you look at the overall framework of what we've done. So what we've done at GSK over the last 8 or 9 years is we've basically tried to systematically look at the business model, both in the developed world, where we've looked at things like pricing, transparency in particular, commercial model, where we're the only company in the world where we don't pay our reps bonuses for how much drug they sell. They're completely unencumbered from that. Those sorts of things are very much the developed world. And in the developing world, we try to create very high level principles under which we operate. Those include, for example, tiered pricing. So we believe, and we will argue very, very strongly, that we think the richest countries in the world should contribute more to R&D than the poorest. It includes, for example, an approach to graduated intellectual property, where we don't assert intellectual property among the poorest countries in the world. Not because we don't believe in intellectual property, but it's actually a completely, it's a waste of time having that conversation in a country which is struggling to keep its head above water. Of course, as countries become more and more economically active, IP becomes critical. But again, part of the framework has been to do that. We made a commitment that in the poorest countries in the world, none of our patented drugs would be charged at a price higher than 25% of the European average, to guarantee that there would be a low ceiling on prices. We've made a commitment that in sub-Saharan Africa, 20% of any profits we make in that region are donated back through NGOs to capacity building, because we think that companies who are operating in these countries ought to play a bigger role in long-term healthcare capacity building. And in the last 5 years, we've funded 11,000 frontline healthcare workers, 11,000 frontline healthcare workers who have now impacted positively 40 million African lives. By 2020, that'll be 150 million. So those are the big programs. And then what we're now doing is we're working with partners to deliver, and I don't want anybody in this room to take the word tactical inappropriately, but we're looking to then fill in within these strategic frameworks really meaningful tactical interventions that make a difference at the ground. So whether that's things like the AMP program in Kenya, Sierra Leone, where, and again, yesterday the Kenyan health minister thrilled with the potential of upgrading those county level healthcare workers, whether it's working with pharmacy in South Africa to make sure that pharmacies have the working capital to operate, whether it's making a very precise scientific intervention on something like chlorhexidine antiseptics, which can make a big difference for babies immediately after birth. Those are all very precise tactical interventions. Now, in some cases, they affect tens of thousands of people. In some cases, they're going to affect hundreds of thousands of people. But that starts to then color in the map underneath those strategic frameworks I just described. What we've tried to do at GSK is not just jump into the tactical program without having put a framework around the whole way in which we engage with the space. That drives enormous consistency, and it drives an understanding in the company that this is not an elected, it's not, we don't work with USAID or Aspen or Save the Children just so we can have a paragraph in the back of the annual report to say we did something in global health, right? That is a relationship, or one of the relationships, which sits within a fundamental definition of the business model of the company and is simply the expression, or the ultimate expression, of how some of this stuff hits the ground.
I'm intrigued by what you said about funding the healthcare workers, 11,000 healthcare workers. What do you mean when you say you funded them?
So what we do is any profit we make in sub-Saharan Africa, and nobody makes a lot of profit in sub-Saharan Africa, but we make some. 20% of that number is essentially allocated to be reinvested back into the country from which it was earned. We use three NGOs, so we don't have any part of the direct delivery for obvious reasons, because you can imagine lots of people might criticize you for it, journalists, for example. So we decided right up front we probably wouldn't put that big target on our back. But what we do is we work with organizations like SAVE and others. They receive the monies, and what they then do is they put that into training of frontline healthcare workers. And as I said, so far 11,000 have been trained under that program.
You've got a blank slate in West Africa right now. Is that a good opportunity for those kinds of initiatives?
It's a challenging space. I mean, every part of Africa has its different challenges. But we have very substantial presences in places like Nigeria in particular. And what we're looking at the moment as one of the next steps is further expansion of our manufacturing footprints in Africa. And the reason why I raise that in the context of all of this is to really be able to develop this program or this approach. You need, of course, the frameworks, you need the initiatives, you need a backbone on the ground where you can drive discipline inside your own organizations. You don't want to be just flying in and out. You need to have a kind of a strong local presence. So we're looking at building up a greater manufacturing footprint. That's very much in step with where Africa leadership wants to go in terms of better indigenous supply independence. They are wary of their continued reliance on imports from elsewhere. So we're going to address that. And as part of that, it's driving a very substantial upgrading of our talent base in Africa. Over the last 2 or 3 years, we've doubled the number of female leaders, for example, in our African business, including in parts of West Africa. And all of that talent base is creating a network around which we can then build the momentum, both within the access and then ultimately the delivery of innovation products.
You've just come down from New York at the UN, and there was the huge issue on antimicrobials. What have you brought away from that?
Well, so I attended the high-level meeting on AMR yesterday, I think. Once you go to New York and the UN, everything just it just merges together.
Wednesday, I think.
Was it on Wednesday? Yeah. Anyway, whenever it was, I was there, and it was great to see that political declaration. I took part in quite an interesting panel to be part of with the Kenyan health minister, Médecins Sans Frontières, ourselves a Russian health minister, and a representative from the South Institute. And I think the bottom line is, first of all, we shouldn't underestimate how rare it is for the UN to adopt a declaration associated with health. I think it's only the third time in the history of the UN the fourth time in the history of the UN. That's a big deal, and I think it does signal something. But we should also recognize that it's a declaration. And even when it comes to hard-edged declarations like security, the UN has a mixed track record of being able to execute and deliver. And I think in this space, there is a tremendous risk of just inevitable inertia and attrition. And so now I think it really is over to a lot of key actors, governments, of course, health delivery agencies, media, and drug companies, plenty of others, to start to play their role. Now, what we announced the day before the panel meeting in the UN was a new roadmap in terms of drug company commitment on this space. We did the first version of this at Davos. We enhanced it this week. And what that really speaks to is it commits companies like GSK, and we led that and we're a happy signatory to it, to things like full audits of everything we're doing in terms of promoting antibiotics to make sure they're not being overused. In GSK's case, we're committed to continued investment in surveillance systems to make sure that antibiotics, people have the information on the ground in the emerging markets to know which antibiotics remain sensitive and which don't. Making sure that all of our manufacturing supply chains are being checked and re-audited so that there aren't inadvertent releases of antibiotics into the water table through the manufacturing system. We're trying to identify the place in which we can help. What's critical now, I think, from the UN perspective is really the UN somehow needs to nominate an agency who basically becomes the fact checker and number counter of this. This needs to have private sector discipline applied to it. Numbers, targets, accountabilities, name and shame, all of those good management principles need to be deployed. Who's going to do that? I don't know. But without that, I'm very skeptical that we're going to see real progress. I think with it, we could see enormous progress. And I'll give you an example of something that's worked very well, and USAID have been a tremendous partner in all of this, and that's neglected tropical disease. Because I think sometimes people look at AMR and they think, oh, you know, it's so big, it's so everywhere, it's just too big to put your arm around. But neglected tropical disease is not dissimilar to that. It's an extraordinarily scaled issue. It's obviously multi-country. It's been an intractable problem for a long, long time. And actually, it was not on the radar at all. There hasn't been an NTD declaration, and I expect there never will be, at the UN. But we've made enormous progress there. How did we make that progress? Back in 2010, I hosted with Margaret Chan and Bill Gates 16 drug companies in London. And we got those drug companies all owned some kind of medicine which had utility in NTDs. In our case, albendazole for lymphatic filariasis. And we got together and we said, look guys, we've all got this technology. Nobody needs to discover anything new. We need to basically get a commitment to make it available to the people who need it through donation. And we need to find a way to get much more of an industrial scale delivery capability behind it. And we got the companies together, WHO, Gates, everybody signed up to this intention to eliminate or largely eradicate a series of NTDs. Since then, the progress has been absolutely massive. For whatever my industry takes for criticism, much of it well deserved. It doesn't get the credit it deserves in this kind of space. The drug companies have delivered every single product they said they would deliver. We're delivering about 1 billion tablets a year of lymphatic filariasis treatment. We're seeing huge impact in terms of diseases now being knocked out country by country or boxed in country by country. And the reason that worked is because there was an alignment, there was a clear commitment from WHO, which helped with the countries. There was a real belief we could make a difference, and then actually the Gates Foundation, in collaboration with some of the companies like GSK, put together just very, very strict scorecards to make sure everybody knew what was going on, and when things slipped, they got called, people got called out, and companies fixed it. And it's that kind of thing that we're going to need on AMR. I don't know who's going to do it, but somebody needs to do it. And without it, I suspect we won't see the progress we deserve in the next few years.
It's a slightly different problem, though, isn't it? Because you need to provide these antibiotics cheaply to countries that can use them, at the same time not wanting them to be overused.
Yeah.
And you don't want to flood a country with a bunch of cheap antibiotics that will just drive resistance.
Yeah, well, it's a multidimensional issue, right? You need new antibiotics. Nobody should give up. Yes, there are cases of examples where bugs are resistant to pretty much everything we have today, But there's massive sensitivity to the drugs we have today for the vast majority of people. So let's conserve what we have. Let's be intelligent about how we use them, number one. Number two, how do we stop people in poorer countries only buying two tablets because that's all they can afford? So they never get an effective dose. They're just giving the bug a bath and letting it get used to the antibiotic. Those sorts of things we need to get hold of and figure out how to fix that. And that's not trivial because it's obvious what's driving that. But that may be more of a donation type of an approach so that people are able to get proper full courses if they need it. How can we and others work with physicians in the developing world and frankly in America and elsewhere to ensure that physicians aren't giving antibiotics unnecessarily just because the patient demands it, making sure the physicians are sufficiently confident to only prescribe when it's truly necessary. What can the diagnostics industry do to create point of visit proof rather than this whole general practice of antibiotics is an empiric business. Huge amounts of antibiotics are written for viruses which don't react to antibiotics. So all of that, if we could knock that out, would have a huge impact. And then there's a question of what's the new business model look like so that if we do successfully develop a new class of antibiotics, and at GSK we have a very exciting program ourselves and we think we do have a new class, but how are we going to manage that? Because as you rightly say, the sensible thing to do is to hold on to that, don't overuse it, which means there's not much of a commercial return. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out how to fix that either through a delinkage type of approach where we separate off, in the case of AMRs, the return for R&D from the price per pack. I think we're hugely open-minded to those sorts of things. My point simply is there have been lots of panels talking about lots of these things. The question now, post the declaration, is we need a management capability to get this done and effectively implemented across the world. And that's probably not the kind of thing that the UN, I think, would naturally claim great ownership of, but we need to figure out who can do that kind of work.
Do you have something in mind?
No, not particularly. I think there's lots of organizations in the world that have those sorts of capabilities. As I said, in the NTD space, companies working with Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation really cracked it. So, you know, logically, I think member state governments ought to be all assigning a minister of antimicrobial, if this is so serious, let's have a minister of antimicrobial resistance in every government, and that person ought to be in that country driving these sorts of measures in terms of making sure that every manufacturing facility is completely abiding by destruction methods, all of that kind of thing, making sure physicians are not being incented in any way to overprescribe. You know, you could, all of that, I think, should be member state level. At the global level, I think something around a delinked model for antibiotic research is not a difficult thing to negotiate or to figure out, and could be done relatively quickly.
I think we'll open it to questions in a minute. While people are getting their questions in mind, and I think there's mics that are going around, I want to ask you, you've talked a lot about Africa today. What about China, which is a different issue, and I believe you spent some time in the Far East. China's different. It's not only a possible partner, but it's also a big competitor for a drug company. Do you see any special opportunities with China? Do you see any special challenges with China vis-a-vis what you're trying to do in Africa?
I mean, it's very different. You're quite right to say that. I mean, of course, it has much greater internal capacities and resources than Africa does at the moment. But it also has a tremendous heterogeneity within the country itself. So if you're in Chongqing or Western China versus Shanghai, you're in a completely different kind of place in terms of some of the healthcare challenges. And over the last two or three years, the new government, new leadership, have really been focused on how to drive much more rationality into their healthcare system. I actually think Chinese leadership have got a very, very clear-sighted view of what they want to do. It's quite a painful process because they've got a system which historically has behaved a lot like a private marketplace almost, but it's going to now be moving much more into something, I'm not going to say NHS or not quite like the UK, but there's certainly something much more uniform in the way it operates for different levels of income in the system. So I think it's going to be built much more appropriately for Chinese patients wherever they are to get the chance of at least some type of decent treatment. That's a huge ambition. It's a massive journey. We've, over the last two or three years, been working very hard with the government to make sure that our strategy really fits with where they want to go. And simplistically, what that's led to is a couple of things, one of which you probably smile at, but is we've reduced our prices in certain areas, but we've seen absolutely massive volume benefits come through on the back of that. And that is very much an obvious example where if you really want to drive access in China, something had to happen around pricing. And that, in particular in hepatitis B, has been a very important, very successful strategy for us. What we've also been doing over the last 7 or 8 years is actually building up our research capacities in China. I don't really see China as a competitor to GSK in its research capacity. And actually, if you look at, it's a very interesting observation, if you look at our industry over the last 50 years, it remains true that the overwhelming majority of innovation in our sector comes from America and 2 or 3 Western European countries. It's not coming from India, it's not coming from Japan, and it's not today coming from China. And what I mean by that is discovery. Biologic discovery, chemical discovery, is a pretty specialized art. And while we've seen in Japan and in India, where there has been a lot much longer history than China of pharmaceutical research, while we've seen significant progress in development, we've seen relatively limited, almost no, real breakthrough scientific discovery.
But they're great at making stuff.
But that's very different to discovering stuff. Mm. It's totally different. It's a completely different skill set, and it requires very long-term ecosystem. It's not a coincidence that the centers in America, the centers in Britain, in Switzerland, are all co-located around well-established, global, absolutely elite universities, which have got very deep foundations in the knowledge base which drives discovery. And that's a challenge. So first of all, you know, I don't see China as a particular competitor. I actually see them as a partner in terms of the way in which we can leverage discovery capabilities in the West with development capabilities in countries like China. Now, over time, I'm sure that will change. But again, you know, it wouldn't have got a company like GSK very far if in 1985 we'd said, okay, we're doing pretty well in Europe, but we won't go to America because they're competing with us. I mean, I think we've got to move on with the world, right? And just as America became the very substantial source of growth over the last 30 years, and companies like GSK engaged in the US in a very fulsome way and have contributed and I think benefited from that, the same is going to happen in China in the next 30 years.
Great. There's probably a lot of questions in the audience. Are there mics going around? People are holding them. Why don't we start on that side of the room since the mics are there?
Thank you. Hi, my name is Claire Wingfield. I'm with PATH. Thanks so much for this. I'd love to get your reaction to the high-level panel on access to medicines, which you were a member of and also wrote a seems now famous response to that was included in the appendices of the report. And this really was, you know, I think a lot of people have been looking forward to the launch of the report, and it came out last week on the sidelines of the UNGA, and I'm wondering, it seemed that there was not necessarily consensus across all of the recommendations amongst panel members, and so I'd love to hear what you think are kind of the next steps. Is this sort of just a report and it's going to sit there? Do you see opportunities for actually trying to improve access to essential health technologies?
Right, thanks. Well, you're obviously a very astute observer of events. No, I mean, it was an honor to be asked to be on something like that. And it was really an interesting group. I mean, a very well qualified group of individuals there. If I had a criticism of the panel, it's not the panel itself. I think the question that was asked of the panel was unbelievably narrow and inappropriately narrow. And of course, then all the panel could do was react to the question. And it also had a very, very short timeline, which meant that while it received a lot of input, it wasn't really able to go very iteratively through the input. There was no opportunity to validate any input. So, you know, if somebody came in and said, you know, the sky is black, okay, that's the evidence, the sky is black. Nobody really had time to go check whether it was. So I have some real frustration, really, because I think that was a bit of a missed opportunity as a consequence of that. I think if it had been a broader question, there'd been more time and more ability to really validate evidence. I think that would have produced a much stronger set of recommendations. There was huge alignment around the fact that an enormous amount has been achieved in global healthcare in the last 50 years. And there was very strong, in fact, I think universal alignment that pharmaceutical industry, for example, has been a very big part of that. But there was always also enormous alignment, total consensus, that more needs to happen. I think the areas where there was less consensus was the degree to which people have confidence in the new ideas versus anxieties about the way things are currently done. And if you read my, as you obviously have, if you read my commentary, which I hope very much, you know, I spent all of August writing that commentary, literally. And there was one very entertaining moment where I was at the last paragraph, just rereading the last paragraph, and I was distracted and hit delete. And you know, it's one of those things where you just, I'm going to be calm, and I'm going to just start again. And it was probably good that I did that. But if you read that commentary, you know, I think that there is an underappreciation of just how complex this undesigned system we all rely on is, and be very careful before you do something which switches it off or somehow pulls the key brick out of the wall, because I have no evidence to say that any of the other Nirvana-type ideas are going to work. So the notion that, why don't we have a global compact where the world funds drug discovery? I don't believe it for a second. I don't think governments are prepared to do that. I think governments like the idea that you have a private sector system which crowd funds in. That's what we do, right? I mean, it's, in a sense, drug companies are a bit... It's like the world's biggest mechanism to suck money in through investors to basically produce a public good. Now, there is huge controversy then with a lot of people about who gets to choose what the price is and how much money should you make, what should the return be. But my goodness, the mechanism of drawing money in to create that public good is incredibly effective. And we're very good at forgetting what it's achieved. We don't wake up at night worrying about hypertension. I mean, when I first joined this industry, hypertension was the scariest thing on the planet. Today, nobody talks about hypertension. We're talking about Alzheimer's, we talk about cancer, but we talk about hypertension. We don't talk about asthma. We don't talk about a whole portfolio of diseases which have essentially been eradicated. We don't talk about childhood death in the developed world because of vaccinations. Extraordinary. And what we forget is that we develop those drugs, and in, you know, 9 out of 10 cases, 8 to 10 years after they're launched, they become essentially free or very low priced for the world in perpetuity. Which is that's an extraordinary model. Now, I'm not saying it's perfect, and I'm not saying there aren't, you know, criticisms of it, but I can't conceptualize how to replace that with a high degree, which is basically my core point in the response. Now, then I step back and you look, let's get to the real guts of the question we were asked, which is the IP system. For me, the killer evidence to say, don't do something crazy with the IP system is the WHO essential drug list. We've just spent half an hour talking about the lack of access in Africa. 75% of the 350 or so drugs on the EDL are off-patent. Nobody has access to those. I mean, everybody loves talking about, you know, and I'm not going to defend any particular product, but, you know, everybody loves the poster child of the Hep C debate. Forget the Hep C. What about paracetamol? What about the basic drugs, which they are not there? Last time I was in on the border of Kenya and Somalia, the one healthcare worker I met who had qualified from a Nairobi hospital 6 weeks before I met him had vaccines and some paracetamol. That's basically it. Didn't have anything else to look after 600,000 people. So, if we've got that, why isn't that working? That's not IP. There's not a single, you know, there's 75% of those drugs that have any IP. So why is that not working? And in fact, we had an excellent conversation with the Kenyan government yesterday exactly to that question. Why don't we now start really digging into what's going on with the EDL? Because what we're going to find there are all sorts of blockages in supply chains, conflicts of interest, misaligned incentives, you name it. That's really where I think we should be going. Now, elsewhere in the panel report, I think there's some really interesting stuff in there. So I think, for example, obliging every private sector company, not just drug companies, but every private sector company to put in its annual report what they are doing to improve the health status of their employee base would be great, right? Because I think that would start to take some burden off governments. I think there's some really important stuff around beginning to experiment around delinkage. I don't think delinkage is a panacea, but I think for AMR it could be enormously powerful. And it's important when you read the report, and the reason why I was prepared to sign the report is because critically in there, it says these ideas are in addition to rather than a replacement of. The reason why I wrote such an extensive commentary is I didn't want to leave open what I believe to be some underestimation of the complexity of the system we have, and frankly a little bit, I think sometimes a little bit of naivety about the thing we've never tried is going to be great, and the thing that's worked for 50 years is terrible. You know, that kind of slightly grass is greener when we're playing with the lives of 6.5 billion people. You know, it's not blowing up the world's R&D machine. Is you better be sure you have something ready to take over, because the day it stops, you have a problem. And that's, so that's really where it is. So next steps, I would focus on the EDL. Why isn't the EDL getting to people in Africa? And I think if there were a sensible next step for the UN in this regard, I would broaden the question out. I think the question was always too narrow, always too sterilizing of the discussion, which is such a shame because there is a lot of richness here. Final point I'd make is I'm absolutely, you can deduce it from what I've just said. I've got no confidence that you can replace this system with another system. This system being innovation stroke production of these things. I've got absolute confidence that there is a portfolio of tools which could help us solve precise issues which are really problematic in the world. But we should get away from this almost religious argument over destroy the system and create a new dreamy system. And we should get much more focused on how do we add or bolt on or amend this system for the NTD problem, for the AMR problem, for the Africa NCD problem that's coming, you know, screaming towards us. Those are very precise issues, and if you get down to those precise issues, as we've touched on this conversation already, you can very quickly get to precise solutions, and then you can start to make an impact. And that's where I would much rather this conversation goes. And what's good about this report is it surfaces a number of tool ideas. What I would strongly recommend is we think about them as a tool set rather than one of them is the panacea, which I think is absolute suicide for the health system.
Sir Andrew, I'm so sorry that this is something you haven't given any thought to. Perhaps you can come back when you've thought about it some more. I think we have time for a couple more questions. How tightly do we need to keep to the schedule?
1:20. But I don't know what the schedule is. What is the schedule?
We can go after.
Just
till 10.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Sir Andrew, thank you very much for your thought-provoking, convincing presentation. Your focus on innovation and access is terrific. I have two questions. In terms of accountability, focusing on the workforce is essential because you could have all the best drugs. If you don't have the workforce to implement it, we're really dead in the water. So who is holding or measuring, holding accountable those you are funding to do the workforce in the field? Number one question. In terms of their outcome.
You mean the GSK workforce, or do you mean
outside? No, the NGOs that you funded.
Yes, I see. Yeah.
And second, what is in the pipeline in this century on the integrative aspects of the brain, the genes, and the microbiome? Thank you.
small subject area.
So, I mean, first of all, we've been very careful in how we select our partners, and we've worked with partners that we've known for years and years in this regard, partners like SAVE, obviously, I think, who are, I think, generally seen at the very top echelon of work in this space. But we also, anybody who works with us has to comply with all of our compliance regulations, much of which includes, for example, our ability to come in and audit and check what's going on. We would, you know, so I think all of these things, I'm not saying they're always perfect, but there's a huge amount of typical business kind of risk mitigation wrapped around these sorts of relationships. I think in terms of your bigger question, where are these enormous research fields going? The brain, we're in the foothills of the brain, I think. And I know there's a lot of excitement and people get very revved up about a phase two study where we can show that this and that looks a bit better. But I think realistically we're only just literally uncovering the pathway. My head of R&D up until a few weeks ago was one of the world's best immunologists, so super smart guy. And he was sat in a room with me, and a building about this size, the building. And he once said to me, he said, Andrew, you've got to remember, if the human brain was a computer, the computer would be the size of this building. I mean, like this whole block that we're sat in. And it's and it's nowhere near as rationally designed as a computer. So how we unpick that, and then again, as a phenomenally eminent immunologist, he was shocked a year ago to be told that the human brain actually has its own immune system, because nobody knew that until a year ago. Can you imagine that? That's a bit, every immunologist in the world just had to relearn. And because we're literally at that level of enormous, so I think we're a long way away. There's a tremendous amount of research going in there. I would like to think we are today in brain disease where we were in oncology in the late 1980s. And hopefully we can go quicker than we have done on oncology, but it feels a lot like that. Now, what we've seen in oncology with the research that's been going on between pharma companies and academia is that there was probably 30 years of foundational research, 70s, 80s, halfway through the 90s. And then as we came into the last 15 years, that foundational research has just created an extraordinarily fertile platform where our understanding and insights have really accelerated. And the progress we've made in the last 5 years are tremendous. The number of drugs coming through there are enormous. Cell and gene is going to be fascinating. We've just had approval in Europe. GSK is the first functional gene treatment. I'm not allowed to call it a cure because we have to wait a lot longer, but so far all the children who've been treated are doing great. So, but this is for ADA-SCID. It's a very rare disease. I mention that because you're going to see more and more of these sorts of gene edit type drugs. And the really big question is, are they going to just be in rare disease, which is fantastic, but are they also going to work in areas like oncology? Because I think there is a high possibility that we might be able to start to manage oncology through the gene as well. So those are the sorts of areas which I think that is more like a 5 to 10 year journey. And then I'm going to just throw in one last one, which you didn't ask, which is bioelectronics, where we think there is a very high probability that there is a significantly fertile field for healthcare improvement, not by using chemicals or even genetic manipulation, but electrical stimulation of peripheral nerve systems. And GSK and Google have created a big company research effort specifically to look at that. And that could lead to single interventions to fix functional failures of organs, which would be phenomenal without any drugs. So I think it's a very interesting space. You know, if I had one message for, you said, brave to come to Washington when people have been hauled up in Congress. Fortunately, I'm not doing that this week. But if I was, I would say to the American policymakers and government, this is not the right moment to lose your faith in what innovation is going to deliver for your people. We might need to work together to make all of this system a bit more sustainable and take some of the rough edges off it. But there's a heck of a lot to come in terms of what innovation might do for people. And I think the potential for cures the potential for single treatments, the potential for things which don't require you to be on drug for life, the potential to get away from tablets every day. Our HIV innovations that are coming could take you to a treatment every 2 months or every 3 months, are all within reach. And that's what we should be striving to make this system work, so that the next generation has the benefit of those drugs, just as we've benefited from the cholesterol drugs, the hypertensive drugs, the respiratory drugs.
More questions? Back there.
Nagesh Bursay, USAID. I agree with your comment on essential drug list, but my question is about access to new technologies, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. Just to give example of the Lancet article on HPV vaccine, which said out of 118 million women vaccinated on HPV, only 1% were from low and middle income countries. So we do have a problem of bringing those technologies to the countries and to the people. I think my concern remains that the people who need the product are not the people who can afford or access the product. And what do you think as a pharmaceutical manufacturer for one of the two companies that manufacture HPV vaccine, how do you think we can fix that problem?
I mean, that particular case, a very interesting example, because at the same time as the HPV vaccine was being introduced, we also were introducing new pneumococcal vaccines and new rotavirus vaccines. And if you look in that period, rotavirus and Synflorix, the GSK pneumococcal vaccine, were both made available in sub-Saharan Africa within about a year of Western approval. So normally vaccines take about 10 years before they get from the developed to developing world. And in both those cases, they went very quickly, and now the vast majority of the volume that we manufacture goes to sub-Saharan Africa. And we've seen for the very first time childhood death rates begin to fall in sub-Saharan Africa, almost completely correlated to the introduction of these two childhood vaccines. So that's been a very interesting case to contrast to the HPV vaccine. There's an issue in the HPV vaccine that the two vaccines have two different profiles. So they both have a profile in cervical cancer prevention. The non-GSK vaccine also has a registered profile in male vaccination. We found that very difficult to then be able to compete in the marketplace, because the governments have tended to say we only want the one with the two indications. And we'd made a decision very early in development that we would develop it as a pure female cancer prevention HPV vaccine, and we didn't do the. We decided not to do the male thing. In hindsight, I'm not sure that was the best decision, but that was a decision we took. But it's very interesting how then the governments have kind of gone down that road, which is really clear. It doesn't matter, when we've made enormous efforts to price that vaccine at a very low level, but because they've made a decision on profile, there's not much I can do about it, realistically. But honestly, if a government tomorrow wanted 10 million doses of HPV, they'd get the deal of the century from GSK. So, you know, we could deal with that very easily for you. So, why does the Rotarix and the Synflorix cases work so well is because there was a very lined up approach with Gavi, and that the funding pool combined with the very competitive prices that we were able to offer. In the case of Synflorix, the advanced market commitment was super critical in terms of how that underpinned our confidence to invest $600 million Singapore dollars in a new building to create the 70 million doses. And now we've seen enormous impact. So this is really solvable. The HPV case has just got a wrinkle in it, which, if you know, frankly, if the people, if you want to vaccinate men and women, then it's obvious which one you should use. But if you're really worried about female vaccination, why are you picking it? Why not compare both? Because the reality is that the GSK one's got a fantastic profile in that regard. But that's basically the story.
In the back.
Hi, I'm from PwC. Just a question on looking at emerging infectious diseases, biosurveillance, and scale-up of vaccines, looking at Ebola, Zika, and GSK's ability to kind of surveil, detect, and then able to kind of scale up manufacturing against those kind of challenges.
I think realistically the surveillance job is not a GSK job. It's a CDC, WHO, possibly Google job, right? And we support things like antimicrobial resistance surveillance. But I think in terms of spotting potential hotspot diseases like this, that's really not our job at all. In terms of development of potential candidate vaccines, we've been involved in everything from SARS, anthrax, if we go way back to the bioterrorism threat, all the way through swine flu and, of course, Ebola. We deployed the first candidate Ebola vaccine. That took us, on the day we were told there was a vaccine required by WHO, I think that was in, I don't know, early August, we were still in animal experimentation, and we had the vaccine in Sierra Leone in January, which is an extraordinary speed of taking something through. But to do that, we more or less had to turn the company upside down. I mean, we suspended a whole series of other development programs. The same immunologist I was telling you about, head of R&D, personally went and spent a week in the labs himself to make sure that got done. Whatever it took, we did it. It's a totally unsustainable approach. And that's why I've been involved in all of these pandemics, and every time there's a pandemic threat, there are fewer and fewer companies volunteering to help. And the reason they're not volunteering to help is because the world is incompetent in its preparation for these situations. And there was a very good session on this at the UN on Monday night with Ban Ki-moon and Margaret Chan. There's been a huge amount of work done since the Ebola crisis to try and get a more fundamental understanding of how we prepare for this space. And I think now everybody buys into the need for us to do something really, really different. Ebola was a huge wake-up call for everybody. And as a result of that, what we're now beginning to see is proper preparation planning going on. So most importantly, an organization called CEPI has been created, supported by a number of member state governments, particularly led by Norway. What that intends to do is to pull together an alliance of the world's biggest vaccine manufacturers, Gates Foundation, Wellcome, WHO, a series of other governments. And it will essentially work through, being advised by an elite independent scientific board, what are the next 10 most likely Ebola threats in the world? What might they be? And actually, you know, there are 10 or 15 of these things. You pretty much know one of them, but you don't know which one. And then this network would essentially commission the companies, and we've made a very strong offer where we are prepared to commit 50% of one of our three global research facilities to this, dedicated. We're prepared to put all of our intellectual property into this, and we're prepared to do all of that at no loss, no gain. So we want our costs covered, but we don't want any profit out of this, because it's unrealistic to expect the pandemic to be the great, you know, the world's on its knees. It's not the time to talk about money. So that's on the table. I think that's going to go forward. I think it's a massive step forward in preparation. Why are we doing this? Because we need to convert this Friday afternoon crisis phone call, please put everything else on hold while you develop Ebola, into something which is planned, done in advance, and we know how to allocate resources to it. And the consequence of this approach ought to be that within 4 or 5 years, this network ought to be capable of producing two candidate vaccines to the end of phase two every 3 or 4 years, so that if you ran it for 10 or 15 years, most of the risks would be covered. What would that mean in the real world? So in the case of Ebola, really, people knew Ebola was there in March. It didn't really become a call out until July and August. But if we'd had this capability, we would have had vaccine on the ground, not January after the March, but probably in the May or the June of that same year. The consequence of that would have been that potentially every single healthcare worker could have been vaccinated before they were flown in. We could have done ring vaccination strategies around the initial outbreaks. And of course, we could have vaccinated over time more broadly, more quickly. So pre-Ebola is just not great. Ebola is a wake-up call. I think the work that's gone on now has been terrific. Great work, collaborative work between governments, WHO, UN, and others, industry. We're in a much better position, and we're just at the edge of about to trigger these things. And if we get this all done, we'll be in a heck of a lot better state.
I think that takes us way over the time that we have left. Sir Andrew,
thank you
very much for your comments.
Thank you.
thank you and the audience for your wonderful questions, and I think there'll be an opportunity afterwards for a few minutes for people to speak.
Thank you very much. Thank you.